Entonces el Señor Dios tomó al hombre y lo puso en el huerto del Edén para que lo cultivara y lo cuidara. Then the Lord God took the man and put him into the Garden of Eden to cultivate it and keep it.
I don't like using a mic. It's okay with you. I'll come down and talk.
Amen.
All right? I want to set the table. I know parents say to their kid, would you go set the table? Would you go put it together? And yes, I want glasses too. And yes, the knife goes on one side, the fork goes on the other. And when you go out, you praise your child for a well done job, or you go, that's not what I told you. Now, what I want to do as we move to this particular text is to set the table. I want to tell you where I come from, and some call it, big word, canonical hermeneutics. Meaning, you take the text and you believe what the text says. Therefore, I do believe that God created the earth in 6 days, and on the seventh day he rested. Mm-hmm. I do believe that according to Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 and 27, that God made man in his own image. In the image of God, he made them, male and female. And I do believe that God took the dust of the ground and created a groundling which we call Adam, who was called Adam, man, out of the earth, breathed into him the breath of life. And I do believe in setting the table that there was really a place called Eden. And in Eden was a garden. And as others have called it, it was a place that would be referred to as paradise. Now our text is concerned, having set the table, that the man now was taken, and he wasn't called to be lazy. Look at the text. The text says he was taken, and he was told that he was going to cultivate the garden. He was going to take care of it. He was going to work at it. He was going to become what we call a good steward. Now jump to the 21st century. There was a theologian by the name of George Eldon Ladd. And Dr. Ladd said this. He said, the kingdom is both present and future. Up our way in Western New York, we have a Bible college by the name of Elam. And the professor of Old Testament there said this. We are going to the kingdom as it is coming to us. Okay, this is a dangerous question. I imagine you play soccer more than you watch football, but you might. Anybody a Redskin fan here? Anybody remember in former times they had a coach by the name of George Allen? Well, George Allen, when he came to this kid, said this. He said, the future is now. And he went out and got all these free agents and hired people and made trades. And guess what? They went to a Super Bowl. But Jesus said something very similar. He said, the kingdom of God is at hand. And he went about preaching the kingdom. And I want to suggest to you today that Seventh-day Baptists, while it doesn't feel like it all the time, are in a place called the kingdom of God. And we have been placed, as it were, in our small space in a garden. And you know what we've been called to do? Cultivate. Work at it. Well, anybody who's done a little gardening knows that you need the right kind of tools to do gardening. I don't do gardening. I'm from the city. I'm from D.C. originally, the area out here in Prince George's County. And because I'm out here, I really never learned how to do a garden. And so my wife Peggy back there, we had a garden for a few minutes, but I pulled up the plants, thinking that they were weeds. So you got to know how to cultivate, and you got to have the right tools to be able to cultivate. And I want to suggest to you the conference theme is the tools that were used to cultivate a garden. Faith, family, and education. Faith, family, and education are our tools to cultivate our garden in the kingdom of God. Faith, family, and education. Now, faith comes in two parts. The first part we know from the book of Ephesians. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is a gift of God, lest anyone should boast. Very simply, it means this. Grace is given to us by God. God gives us grace so we can do something. What is that? Called to make the field by faith. But it is not, and let's say it again, it is not by works of righteousness. We can't be good enough to make heaven. We can't be good enough to have the forgiveness of sins. It is only by grace that God gives that that occurs. And that's the first part of faith. The first part of faith. But the second part of faith is something like this. It is dogma. It is doctrine. It is distinction. Now, here's some truths. I believe in the second coming of the Lord Christ.
Amen.
But I'm not a Seventh-day Adventist. I believe in something called prevenient grace. That means God extends the grace to us whereby we can make a decision for Jesus Christ and for the kingdom of God. But I'm not a Methodist. I believe that at the same time man is both saint and sinner. But I'm not a Lutheran.
Same message.
I believe in the sovereignty of God. But I'm not a Presbyterian. Can you guess what I am? Well, I'll tell you. I'm a Baptist. I'm a Baptist. I believe all those things. And I do believe those things that identify me as a Baptist. I believe in the priesthood of believers. I believe in congregationalism. I believe in the authority of Scripture. And I believe in a hedge of separation between church and state. Oh, I also believe, here's something very significant, in the independence of a local congregation. Each congregation stands upon its own. Can I be a heretic for a moment? The Seventh-day Baptist statement of belief uses this word called autonomy. Autonomy came into Baptist life as a psychological term. It meant, I'm self-sufficient. Why do you know when your husband says he can do everything? He can't. Husbands, you know when your wife says she can do everything? She can't. You need each other. Amen. And yet you are two not autonomous persons because you need each other. You are two independent persons. There is no hierarchy amongst Seventh-day Baptists or amongst Baptists at all. There is no general conference or no general council saying, this you must do. You as a local church pray. You as a local church come to understanding. You as a local church say, what is our mission? And you go and you carry it. But there's a second part, second tool. And I refer to this, say, since we're doing three of them, you know that little prong, three-prong, cold thing that you're digging around with when you work in the garden? Well, the second part that I'd like to suggest to you is family. Pastors, where are you at? Come on up here for a moment, or stand right there. I just want to ask this question. Okay, this is an experiment on my part. You see, where we come from, English-speaking Seventh-day Baptists, isn't that great? We have a separation here, English-speaking Seventh-day Baptists. Okay, where we come from that group, we all go, oh, look, you're a Davis, you're a Burdick, you're a... Kroniger doesn't make it too much. But you are, and they go, everybody goes, yeah, we go all the way back to the Mayfly. Actually, we go back to Rhode Island for the first Seventh-day Baptist church in the States. Well, do you have that same problem amongst non-English-speaking Seventh-day Baptists?
No, we don't.
Oh, you don't? Okay. But guess what you get to do? You get to be the beginning of that kind of family. Where you see, we're going to call it a generational family. And what we're after is not just us coming to know the Lord Christ as Savior, not just us following what Scripture teaches, but we're wanting our children and our grandchildren and our great-grandchildren to do the same.
Amen.
You are the beginning of that relationship where they will say in the future, and they'll use your name. Because it is important for us to pass on what God has done in our lives to the next generation and to the next generation until Jesus comes. But family also has another meaning. I had a friend of mine, he's the late Pastor John Platt. John sat in the kitchen in a place called Verona. That's where we have a Seventh-day Baptist church. He was a pastor there. And he took out a brown paper bag. I know, we only see plastic nowadays, but that's what we used to use in the grocery store. And he pulled it out, and he began drawing all the relationships that occurred in his church. And he, this family is, and almost made a family tree of them. But there were some people that didn't fit into the family. And yet, you know what? They were adopted into the family. They were just as much a part of that family, that church, as anyone who had relatives that were biological. And he began to think about it, and he began to work with it, and as he did, he presented to us that we as Seventh-day Baptists are what we call a kinship system. And sometimes we might call it a fictive kinship system. That means my kids, for instance, in our church at Albert Station, have aunts and uncles that aren't their aunts and uncles. Anybody ever had that? Had aunts and uncles that aren't your aunts and uncles? People that are related to you, they claim you as theirs, like they adopted you into their family, but really you're not part of their family, but you are part of their family. You see, that's exactly what kinship system means. And what it means most of all is nobody that walks through those doors to worship should be alone. Have you ever been on an elevator and felt alone in that elevator? You watch people. They go all the way back against the back. Nobody can touch them because they're by themselves. Oh, there's 12 other people in the elevator, but they're by themselves. When a person walks into church, that's how, for the first time they come in, they often feel. Kinship says the same. Go give them a hug. Love them. Because they now belong to the family. Third part. And that's the third part of that tool that we're going to use. It is the part called education. So we have faith. We have family. And now we have education. Seventh-day Baptists in the past, I'm going to give you some names because these were the schools that we helped found and they're no longer in existence. Salem College in West Virginia. Alfred University, no longer Seventh-day Baptist School. They exist, but they're not Seventh-day Baptist School. Milton is totally gone. And we went overseas and took that kind of education with us. We went to a place called Jamaica, and in Jamaica there was Crandall High School. We went to a place called China, and in China there was Grace in Shanghai. Still in existence today. We went to a place called Malawi. And there we have Likabula Bible Institute. Try saying that 5 times. Likabula Bible Institute. The point is, it may be time for us as Seventh-day Baptists to consider that kind of concentrated, institutionalized education again. But it's not there. So what do they do? What do we do? I'm going to suggest 3 things. First of all, we memorize the Word of God, the Bible. Remember I set the table? I said I believe the Word to be the Word, and because of the way I'm going to use canonical interpretation, I'm going to say what it says is true. Therefore, we have to memorize it. Do you know you have a promise? Your promise is this: the Holy Spirit will bring to your remembrance as you have need. Now, I may be a little wrong, I may scratch my head a little bit, but you see, I cannot remember something I haven't remembered. If I haven't put it into my memory already, I can't remember it. All right, so when you kick him, when he doesn't remember your birthday or your anniversary, what we say is, Maybe. That's like the prick of the Holy Spirit that comes along and says, I remember. So memorize where you go. Let me give you something you can do. Your pastor will have received in the mail something known as memory verses for this year. There are 90. Yes, they're in English, but I bet you somebody here can translate them. And you can memorize the Word of God. You can do that. Now, how hard is it? The very first verse is from Hebrews 11:1. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the assurance of things not seen, that kind of thing. You know how many words there are in that verse? 15. The normal month has how many days? 30. So a person says, I can't memorize, can try to memorize one word a day. And guess what? They still have 15 days left over. Now, there are 9 verses. And this thing started 29 years ago, this kind of Bible memorization. Imagine a person memorizes 9 verses every year. That would mean that they would have memorized more than the number of verses in James and 1 Peter and 2 and 3 John. Memorize God's Word. But here's the second thing. Study God's Word. And study isn't doing this. I'm waking up in the morning and going, okay, I read 2 verses, I'm done, that's great. Study means turn off NCIS, turn off The Office, turn off some of those programs on TV, and sit down with your Bible and look at a chapter or a paragraph and ask this question. Who, what, why, where, when, how? And until you've done that, don't say you studied it. And then you go back to TV or your football game or whatever you watch. But study the Word of God so you can rightly handle it according to our text. And then the third thing you can do, and I heard you all do this already. This is exciting to hear. I understood that before we had this worship service, you all had Sabbath school. Is that right? Yeah. Isn't that great? Because Sabbath school means that iron can sharpen iron. Iron can sharpen iron. It means that I'm prepared to come. And it means I've studied God's Word during the week. And now I can share that with my brothers and my sisters. And you know what? Sometimes I'm going to sound different than other people. And they're going to sound different than me. And that's okay. Because they're teaching me. And I'm learning in Sabbath school. Now, how many people love being in Sabbath school? Dr. Ernest Davey Jr., who used to be the executive director of the Seventh-day Baptist Board of Christian Education, was asked that by Dr. Lloyd out of the Southern Baptist Convention. Now, Dr. Elder Lloyd said this. He asked Dr. Ernest a question. The question was, how many people that are in your worship service do you expect to be in your major educational program? Well, let's hedge our bets, right? Let's say 80%. And that's the answer that Dr. Ernest gave. Well, guess what? He was turned to and he said, wrong answer. That's not enough. Because until you have 100% of your people in Sabbath school that are in worship, you have not completed your task and have not succeeded. Now, there's a balancing there, right? Because you all are always going to be out winning people to Christ. Which means what? New people are coming to church. Which means that unless you invited them also to Sabbath school, they're not going to come to Sabbath school. And you're going to have people say that you've got to keep inviting to Sabbath school. So it's a twofold thing. It's always going to be expanding Sabbath school. You may never reach 100%. But that's your goal. We're in the kingdom of God. God has called us to cultivate it. And he did Adam to cultivate the garden.
has some tools. The tools are faith, family, and education. The question comes now, how are we going to use them? So I'd like to ask you to do me a favor. Would you bow your heads for just a moment? Close your eyes. I'm not going to be looking. It doesn't help me if I look because I have eye problems. If you're here today, and you know that if Jesus would return right now, you would be with him. I want you to raise your hand. Thank you. Now, you can look up and look out. If you didn't raise your hand, and I don't know who you are, I want you to have the assurance that if Jesus would come right now, you would be with him. I want you to find somebody you believe is a believer and let them share with you how you can come to know the Lord Christ this day, how you can begin a personal relationship with him. But now I want to talk to you about who, those of you who did raise your hand. Because you see, by raising your hand, you said, I'm a believer, I'm a Christian, I have a responsibility. You sure did. And that responsibility is to pass on to others faith, family, and education. You have that responsibility. Why? Because you raised your hand. Do you remember when Jesus and Peter were having a conversation? He said this, if you love me, feed my sheep. If you love me, faith, family, and education. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for my brothers and sisters here.